Well, Senator Tom Udall, thanks for taking some time to chat with us about the federal response. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Pleasure to be with you today.
Thanks. As we speak, an agreement has just been reached in Washington, D.C. for, as you just said, you're calling it version 3.5 of the federal response or the stimulus. Can you run down what's in there for us?
Sure. Well, first of all, the big issue was we had run out of money in the small business appropriation, which was basically money, it's called the PPP program, which means that that money goes to a company, they get a loan, but if they keep 90% of their payroll or above going and paying people, then at the end of the time period of the loan, it becomes a grant. And so the whole idea there is we know that people can't go to work because of the coronavirus, but what we're getting is keeping the employees employed and paid so that they can do their thing at home and help the company in any way, but they're ready to go when we're able to go back to work.
And Senator, that definition of payroll, my understanding is it's fairly broad, so it can be used to pay for things like health benefits or 401k contributions on the side of the employer, something like that?
Yes, it's very broad. It's flexible in the sense of just keeping the employees on the payroll. I think that's the main push, and it puts money in the pockets of those who need it. I mean, if you were, you know, if you're giving money to shareholders, that's one thing. But in a crisis like this, if people are subject to being laid off and they don't know they have a job, you could have real disruption. And so this keeps them employed, keeps them paid. And then when the economy's ready to go back and get into gear, we're ready to stand it up and get going.
The New York Times recently has been doing some reporting on oversight of this money. They reported that larger companies, places like Potbelly Deli, which is a national chain, a biotech company that was incorporated in I believe it was Singapore. These are companies who are getting access to this money. And in fact, they're able to hire attorneys, teams of attorneys to file their federal response. That's not what a lot of people have in mind when they think about where this stimulus should go. Is there anything in this latest round that would correct that or provide more robust oversight?
Yeah. Well, what we did here is we were worried about that, too. We've been asking for that information. We have really pushed for everything we could get in terms of the metrics of how it was going out and the impact it was having. They've given us very little, and I'm glad that somebody's doing the oversight here. But what we have additionally, $60 billion going to small lenders in small rural areas. So that money can go out to the people that really need it. These are the smaller businesses. These are the ones that were neglected in the last package. And so that's something that's important that we've added. Secondly, we've added $50 billion to the economic disaster program, and then also another $10 billion to a grant program for people that are really vulnerable in terms of the economy. And then we've got another $75 billion in terms of the emergency needs in the healthcare system. And then finally, the testing, as we all know, is the key to getting back to work. So we have additional money for testing and for contact tracing, which will really make a difference in terms of getting back to work.
It sounds as though most epidemiological experts think that it's not possible to go back to work and avoid another spike in cases without that kind of robust testing and contact tracing. Can you talk to me about the importance of that effort as it goes alongside of perhaps relaxing some of these stay-at-home orders?
Yeah, I think we're trying to find the right balance here. You know, we're talking about saving lives and making sure that we keep the economy in a good position so that it can snap back and start working again. And the key is knowing what's happening in our communities in terms of the testing. If we know from the testing that it's not going up, it's leveling off, it's going down, then we're in a much better position in terms of allowing the people to start going back to work. If you have contact tracing and you've gone back to work, you identify who it is that's infected, and then you're able to go into the community and contact all the people they were exposed to and keep them at home. And so it's a real judgment call. I think it's a judgment call in terms of science and our public health people. Here in New Mexico, the governor has a good epidemiological team that's working with sure that we save the lives, but we're also ready to stand up the economy.
Folks have been somewhat critical of the White House response. I think it largely depends on where you are on the political spectrum, unfortunately. But as you look at what exists in terms of a national testing plan, policy program, however you want to term it, what do you see, and are you encouraged by that?
Well, I don't see a national testing plan. It's clear to me the announcements out of the White House, the coronavirus task force that's out of the White House, keeps saying over and over again, this is up to the governors. That isn't the way it should be. I mean, we should have a national program where if we have tests that aren't needed in one place, we can move them to another. If we have a hotspot, we can address the hotspot and get on top of it. And we're not doing that right now. I'm going to sign on to legislation that creates a national program that puts a major person behind it. A lot of people call for a czar or something like that. And that's the direction we need to head in under the Defense Production Act, because when you have an emergency like this, you need one person in charge and out there dealing with supply chains, dealing with hotspots, and getting things to the point where we can get this under control and get people back to work.
And the Defense Production Act, that's the legislation whereby the president is able to order businesses to produce certain critical material. We're thinking, of course, of planes and ammunition. Here we're thinking of PPE, that sort of thing. Are you clear on whether or not the Defense Production Act has been used, or did GM and Ford just start producing ventilators on their own?
I don't believe that we're in the position to know, because there hasn't been the transparency we need. I mean, several times the White House and others have made announcements, then there's very little in terms of what's behind that announcement. How's it happening? So I think that's why you have basically a czar that would come out and say, this is what we're doing, answer questions every day, and be in a position to release all the information that's been collected. Now it's state by state, governors putting it out, and the governors need help. You know, some of these governors are well under and have their hospitals full. Others don't have as bad a situation, but we're in this together, and we need to make sure we get the testing, we get the contact tracing, and we get this under control before we put people back to work.
You mentioned the part of the stimulus package, this latest one that will go to smaller rural banks. I know you've been paying attention to smaller rural hospitals as well. They're in kind of an interesting situation, it seems, where like other bigger hospitals, they've stopped doing elective procedures, but they don't quite have the influx of perhaps COVID-19 patients, at least here in New Mexico, that we've seen elsewhere, unless you're talking about, of course, the northwest corner of the state. That's a lot to get in there, but what's your read on the situation of rural hospitals in New Mexico right now?
Well, I think our smaller hospitals are hurting, and it's because on behalf of they kind of cleared the patients out on these non-essential surgeries. They said, we're going to postpone those. And that was their revenue for this period. The model seemed to show we were going to peak earlier than we did. The peaking date has been moved back. And I think the governor's trying to work with them in terms of maybe allowing something to go on there in terms of patients and having revenue come in, but also anticipating the peak going forward and needing to have all the hospital beds available for coronavirus patients.
There is money in the stimulus package for rural hospitals. Is that correct?
Yes. And there was money in the last package, there's money in this package, and we will keep monitoring what's happening with the rural hospitals. There are also a classification called critical access hospitals, where there's money that hospitals can get there. And I know some of our hospitals here in New Mexico are trying to qualify for that.
Okay. You sit on the Commerce Committee, I believe appropriations as well. Is that correct?
That's right.
How will this money be coming to New Mexico? Is it through existing programs? Is this just a lump sum? Can you, without getting too deep into it, can you give us an idea of how this money flows?
Yeah, let me give you different categories that we've talked about here. First of all, on the hospitals, there are providers in New Mexico that are plugged into Medicare and Medicaid. And so the government has all of their numbers and has their accounts and is able to work out a formula and send the money out. We've already had a substantial amount of money released to hospitals. Secondly, the money for states, localities, cities, and tribal entities, tribal governments, that money is being released as we speak. There is in that pot for New Mexico and state governments and the city of Albuquerque $1.25 billion. And so that money is starting to move out, and we've agreed, and the president has put this out on a tweet, that money going forward is going to be able to be used for lost revenues. And that's the situation New Mexico's in right now, unfortunately. We're losing revenue dramatically because of the oil and gas industry, because of a number of other things that are going on, because you just don't have the economic activity that brings in the revenue. So those are a couple of the areas where the money will come in. The tribal governments have their own pot that I fought for, first time in history, that $8 billion is going to flow to the nation's tribes. That's being set up at the Department of Treasury and will move out to the tribes, I believe, by April 24th. So there are a number of places where federal government in appropriations is also sending out money. For example, the Bureau of Indian Affairs is getting additional money to help with the tribes. The arts community is getting additional money under the standing programs that are there. And there's money across the board for programs like housing and other programs that are ongoing, that we push those up a little bit. So the good thing is we have substantial infrastructure in place in terms of programs, and we're able to send the money out, and the people there, like the SBA, can get the money out immediately.
I know there was some frustration among the tribes at the first round of stimulus. I understand that it was going through the CDC, which is an unusual program as opposed to the BIA. You mentioned the Treasury. Has that been fixed, and will this be sort of a simpler process?
Well, the Treasury's been very slow. They've been very slow on their consultation with tribes. We hope they'll get their money out the door on April 24th. So that's very disappointing. The money to the Indian Health Service, a good chunk of that was released. We've also seen some of the newer machines be sent to the Indian Health Service, the testing machines. So some of it's working, some of it isn't. We're doing everything we can to put pressure on the administration to get this right and to get the money out the door and get it into the hands of the people that are helping. Mainly, these are the frontline workers.
I know we just have about a minute left here. I know you like to get outside and walk and hike as much as you can. Have you been doing that? And what has been the attitude of people that you've seen on the trails that you've been able to hike around on?
Well, I've been out a little bit on my own property and then on some trails that I know of that nobody's on. But from everything I've seen in the community here, kind of on the foothills of the Santa Fe Mountains, people are very respectful. They're very far apart. If they meet on a trail that's not 6 feet wide, people move off the trail. People are wearing masks. I wear a mask any place I go outside the house. And so it's important that we keep up this social distancing and then keep those masks on, because they're there to protect everybody else in terms of the aerosols that people catch this from.
Sure. Senator, I want to thank you for your time, for joining us, explaining a little bit about it. I'm assuming we'll probably talk to you again before this is all over.
Well, thank you. Thank you for getting out the word to everybody. Really appreciate it. You take care.